Hey, hi, hello everybody, and welcome to yet another build showcase for XCOM 2 Long War 2. I'm Faleg, and before we start, just a little pre-info that is important. Namely, these builds are not made with the min-maxing and absolute best possible stats in mind. Those builds are made in mind specifically for aggressive and fast gameplay. And they are made to work best with each other, but they should work pretty much standalone as well. Though, of course, if it is a configuration that I haven't tested, then the quality is not guaranteed and you cannot get your money back. Once the build is touched from the shelf, you are being considered as acknowledging the fact that you are, learning about that build, and the Faleg Industries are not responsible for soldier deaths on the battlefield. Yeah, okay, the last part is just screwing around. Anyway, last episode we were talking about a combat medic specialist, so today we're gonna be talking about a combat hacker specialist. So let's go straight for the armory and find ourselves a specialist, shall we? Blind. There we go. We have the Valence X with some police unit, bulletproof vest, and pyjama pants. So that's the best option ever. And anything else I have to say about the combat hacker before we actually go for it? No, let's go, let's start. So, as usual, I'm going to be talking first about the stats of the unit that are necessary. Then we're going to talk about perks, finally equipment and gear, and last but not least, I will intertwine somewhere in the middle and put a little info about the end, about the tactical use of the unit. So, let's get to the meat of it, shall we? We had a long enough introduction. So, this build is... Actually, I found it much more useful on lower difficulties, some of the first three difficulties, than it is on Legendary. First, mostly because it doesn't really focus itself so much on the healing, and while you can avoid the wounds to a bigger extent on lower difficulties with aggressive play on Legendary, then well, you're simply going to get wounded and incapacitated, stunned and so on people eventually. So all in all, if you are playing Legendary, the medical specialist is going to, I think, outweigh the benefits of the combat hacker. However, absolutely nothing stops you from using both in a single squad. You're just gonna have, all that more awesome squad. That's and have to resign from some other class. That's all up to you and your playstyle. So let's talk about stats. First of all, for this guy, we need, of course, the hack, and secondary is the aim, because this is a combat hacker, so he's going to be shooting and hacking, not healing and hacking. Thus, there are other important stats that choose the hack. I would actually even say that aim is a more important stat than the hacking stat, because you get a failsafe eventually, and your gear plus small items used by other teammates will reduce the enemy's tech score, but nothing will really improve your aim all that much. So I would say that the first priority with that build is aim. Second, but also very important, is the hack. So, and other stats aren't really all that important. You probably want to have a decent mobility, but it's not necessary for that build. You can always carry a fewer small items, right? And let's move to the perks. Of course, we have the hacking skill on the first, but on the Lance Corporal, the biggest change already from the, usually used specialist on the field is that we take neither combat protocol nor revival protocol. We take Sentinel. So we can take two reaction shots in an Overwatch. It is very, very simply going to be the workhorse skill of that build, and thus it is absolutely necessary. So we are resigning from medical protocol. We cannot send the gremlin to heal somebody on the field, and we can't really use combat protocol, but we get two overwatches, and that's good, because Sentinel is great, because Sentinel is good, and we are going to be building up on top of this. So of course, on the second rank, we are taking covering fire, so that we can take additional actions, additional overwatch fire, not only against enemy movement, but also other actions. So if you remember the Ranger Overwatch Specialist, Overwatch Ranger build, You will probably see there is already a synergy between covering fire and covering fire between the Ranger of Overwatcher running and dashing through the enemy field to get his free Overwatch while flanking enemy up close, and from the back you have covering fire being used by the combat specialist, making sure that whatever happens you are going to get so much fire on flanked enemies that you're gonna have to kill them. They just won't survive their own turn, even if they try to do something other than running. Then either your Ranger Overwatch guy or the Specialist Overwatch guy are gonna get their mark. But it is especially useful if you are, of course, not facing enemies that are in full cover. So, for example, enemies that don't use cover, or enemies that no longer have cover because it's been destroyed, or the enemies that have been flushed out. You know the drill, right? So covering fire is an important part of this build, and there is no doubt that we are going to need it, even though it was only one of the possibilities for the Overwatch Ranger. Here it's absolutely necessary. You can possibly take interference, but we are talking about squad that already has a stun ranger and a lightning reflexes ranger in the team, so what would be the point, really? You will simply not ever be facing that many Overwatches to actually care about that. It's like literally not gonna happen, probably, throughout all the 100-something episodes. I've yet to see an option when I had to, in a full squad, had to use interference. So, covering fire, it is. And let me get that in a square, right? So, the next important part is... I'm sorry, Revival Protocol is allowing you to remove stuns and stuff. Yeah, but it doesn't change anything, my bad. I was just wondering the whole time what did I omit, and now I know that I screwed up Medical Protocol with Revival Protocol again. I'm sorry. So, on the next turn we can take Trojan, so that if we hack an enemy, mechanical enemy of course, then when the hack ends, then the enemy is gonna take some damage. It's not gonna be all that especially great damage, you can maybe kill a drone with it if you're lucky. And also, Scanning Protocol would be the choice for you, because you can reveal faces on maps, and you can reveal a lot of the map, especially if you are not using Scouting Protocol mod or don't have a Shinobi in the squad, which I usually don't. So Scanning Protocol is the absolute better choice to Trojan, simply because Trojan is crap, and Medical Protocol is useless without its other supporting perks. However, if you like Trojan and you find it useful in your gameplay, then of course have at it. I'm gonna mark it as a maybe, so take this 50-50. You can take it if you wanna. I do not personally like it. And on the Staff Sergeant, there is our favorite perk number, number one for Overwatch builds, Ever Vigilant. And that means that, yes, in combination with the Ranger Overwatcher, your combat hacker is going to be the absolute freaking beast when it comes to eliminating enemies, because he can just run to the end and get his thing done. However, you can use airdrop in a combination in the squad with a Grenadier, because that's a very useful skill as well, and we are already talking about squad that contains an Overwatch Ranger, so it's not going to be all that important. However, if you want to use this guy to also provide some medical support for your team, which would be a good idea, especially on Legendary difficulty, Field Medic probably is gonna be able to carry you over throughout most of the missions without any need for assisting tools. So, basically what this means, if you are not using the Ranger Overwatcher, the Ever Vigilant is the perk for you. If you have a gunner in the team, airdrop is the perk for you. If you have no other medical combat specialist to take care of healing, or not every one of your people carries their own medkits, because I've seen people also do that, then the field medic is going to mean that your combat hacker can also, in a crunch, work as your fixer-upper. However, I'm gonna go with Ever Vigilant, because we are actually going all the way down. And that gives us... Actually, no, I'm sorry. Field Medic or Airdrop are going to be more important than ever Vigilant, because the way I see it, we are always going to be doing something with our Gremlin before the ending of the turn, and we are actually very rarely are going to spend all our actions on moves. It's probably gonna happen at the start of every mission, so that is really a 50-50. So I'm just gonna go like mini, 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 mo. Field Medic it is, and I'm gonna scratch the all of them with dots instead of squares. They are all equally useful depending on your playstyle and the squad composition that you are taking, so it's very, very hard to actually pick up a surefire winner in this case. However, since we are talking about the combat hacker, we are going to have to resign from Cool Under Pressure, because failsafe is simply that important. And I can't really stress that enough. That's just how I feel, really. Cool Under Pressure is great, and having the opportunity to crit with Overwatches is absolutely bloody amazing. But the failsafe is going to be basically the reason why hacker is a hacker, really, because you are going to avoid the negative connotations of the things that you do if you fail. So failsafe is definitely all the way over here, unless nothing, really. Failsafe is a must for a hacking unit, and we already have an Overwatch Ranger that does the Cool Under Pressure, so having a support Overwatcher to finish the stragglers is, I think, good enough. Now, next on, we have a very difficult choice between the threat assessment and full override. So it depends. If you want to have mechs in your own bases, or if you find that having a permanently hacked mechanical unit during the mission is a thing that is important enough, then that's a good perk for you. I, however, think that threat assessment is actually better, because that way you can support your Ranger Overwatcher with additional options, basically allowing him to, for example, open fire twice in the turn and then still get a covering fire from threat assessment, or have your other Overwatch unit get that Overwatch, or have a, you know, guy. For example, you can use your Gremlin with threat assessment on your unit, and then you can shoot somebody. It's all way too versatile to replace it with basically a gimmick that is full override. Don't get me wrong, full override is great for base defense missions and having defense missions and stuff like that, but it is a gimmick. And having a permanently controlled mech may sometimes save your bum, but more often than not you're gonna have to kill that mech anyway. And having a temporarily controlled mech is just as good. You can just make a suicide run and take care of all your enemies like this. So it is not as good as threat assessment, that is simply very, very important. However, if you feel that full override fits your game style better, then by all means I am going to mark it as a choice for this build, because it will work one way or the other. The build works, it's not very complicated. Now, the biggest and most controversial perhaps change would be the capacitor discharge changed with kill zone, and that is a very, very difficult choice, to be honest, because later in the game you will meet so many guys that having the kill zone to just be the pinnacle of the Overwatch 3 would be great, but so many of those guys that you meet are gonna be mechanical enemies that I feel, at least, that capacitor discharge is simply going to pull you out of way too many messes, and you can I'm pretty sure that you can do that. You can put an 8 protocol on yourself to get the Overwatch and then use capacitor discharge. It may not work due to reasons that are unknown to me, and I actually haven't tested that particular part because it just right now came to my head, but there is nothing that stops it from working, really. Threat assessment 8 protocol doesn't end your turn, and you can't use and you can use capacitor discharge with your second action, as far as I'm concerned. The only thing that worries me is that it may remove the Overwatch, but I really much very much doubt it. So capacitor discharge is simply going to be more useful than Killzone late game. Killzone would be absolutely amazing before you start seeing mechs every mission and sectopods and all the other fun and dandy people that wear armor making Overwatch fire, especially one that doesn't crit against them, slightly less useful than the humongous damage that Capacitor Discharge does, that it is simply way better, in my opinion. Of course, if you feel like Killzone is good for you, it is a valid choice. I just can't bring myself to actually ever take it, really. Because your Overwatch fire can miss, the armor can deflect it, and then you have that freaking graze mechanic that don't even get me started on that. That sometimes activates itself even after you disable it. Because, you know, well, it replaces dodge, so enemies with high dodge can still be grazed. Anyway, the removal of the graze band just removes the additional graze band, but you can still graze your shots. Why is that happening to this game? Yeah, anyway, Capacitor Discharge, in my opinion, is simply way more useful than Killzone. However, you can combine Killzone with the Overwatch Ranger for some actually pretty lovely combos, pretty much wiping the floor with enemy infantry, especially if both your Ranger and this Overwatch Specialist are using the shotgun. It's just beautiful. In any case, let's talk about gear. So, what we want for this guy is, of course, we want the mods that give him additional ammo, because he's overwatching a lot. We want the trigger, because it gives additional accuracy during overwatch fire, which is what we do. We want the PCSS that increase hacking, because it's super important. And on teammates, we want blue and red screen rounds to reduce the enemy resistance to being hacked and generally screwed with the use of the drone. And of course, you want him to have the gremlin that is on very, very much high-tech as is possible. Now, that being said, I don't think there are any other special additives that you can put on this guy. That's basically how the gear is going to look for him. If you have low mobility, you can of course get a down out of some of the small items, so you don't have to carry all that much. You don't really need any grenades or anything other than, you know, some sort of ammo to help you crit and reduce the enemy hacking defense perhaps. And of course a medkit if you are using the field medic. Other than that, we are about as golden as we can get with that build. And as you can see, it's a pretty straightforward one, so there isn't all that much to be talked. And he, of course, is being used in the mid-range, just like the Ranger Overwatch guy. But you want to keep him a little closer to to the people, so he can actually use that medkit. You want to be able to use aid protocol before spotting at the Overwatch, so you can cover yourself or somebody else's arse while you are overwatching. Threat assessment, of course, helps very, very much, especially if you put it on somebody else, because I'm not exactly sure you can shoot or use capacitor discharge with threat assessment on you without removing the overwatch. Yeah, I think it would stand to reason that you could, but I actually never tested it, so who knows. If you have specific information, does that work well with the current version of Longor, let us know in the comments. I'm sure it's going to be much appreciated by of everybody else, and of course it's going to be very much appreciated by me. So, that's pretty much it about this build. Let me know what you think about it, what changes would you make to it to fit your game style, and what improvements would you have in mind for it, of course, and generally, are you using something like this also, because this build is a little eclectic and is trying to be a jack of all trades somewhat. But I think it is keeping a somewhat useful focus as a team support, right? Anyway, looking forward to hearing from you. Hope you really enjoyed this video. If so, you can press the like button, subscribe if you haven't and want to. And you can check out other videos on the channel and even support me on Patreon if you wanna. And with that, I'm going to be saying bye-bye. See you next time. I've been Falek.